Hickok 45 here. Today we're going to talk about shooting steel. We get so many questions about that. I've answered a lot of people on Facebook and on YouTube about, you know, how far should the steel be away and isn't that dangerous? Don't you get ricocheted? And have you ever been hit by a piece of lead and all that kind of thing? Flashback, splatterback, and ricochet. And we have an FAQ on it, a very brief thing. And I answer people sometimes if I can. I can't answer everybody. One of the things I always say, though, is you shoot steel at your own risk, okay? In a lot of ways, it goes against common sense, doesn't it? Shooting something hard like that. And when I, growing up, that's what my dad always taught me, and anybody that knew anything about shooting, you know, don't shoot a rock, don't shoot anything, you get ricochets and nothing hard, it'll bounce back at you, and all that kind of thing. So here we go. Look at all the shooting competitions, whether it's IPSC, IDPA, steel shoots, or what's the speed shoot called? The steel challenge, I think, a famous shoot, cowboy action. Yeah, I mean, everything involves shooting steel now. So what's wrong with everybody? Is everybody stupid? Maybe. Everybody's willing, I guess we could say, to take the risk. Now, the risk is generally limited. If you got eye protection, good eye protection, and you're smart about it, you can shoot steel fairly safely. Again, there's always a risk. You make your own choice, just like when you get in a car or you skydive or you shoot a bow and arrow, whatever you do, you know, life is full of risks. Now, what I want to do is give you some ideas that will make it safer, not totally safe, but safer. I'll give you an idea about the evolution of shooting steel right here kind of took place. This is one of the very first plates I had made when I moved here and bought this place back in 1986, because I love shooting plates. And I had them angle it a little bit. If you notice on the pedestal, it is angled a little. I think my first set of plates, I didn't have that angle. And then I couldn't find one of those. But then next time I had some made, because I was getting a little bit of lead back, I said, well, angle that a little bit, because some of it's coming back. Well, you still get it. Why do you get it? Because when you hit, imagine throwing a water balloon. It's kind of like throwing a water balloon at a flat surface, if you can imagine that. Not that most of you have ever thrown a water balloon, right? And where that water is going to go, it's just going to go in all directions and mostly downward. Well, it gets to here, and it can kind of come back out. Now, it's not going to come back out, well, if it's a bullet going 1,000 feet per second, it's not going to come back 1,000 feet per second, but still, it could have enough velocity and big enough piece that could hurt you. And I've seen that happen. That has happened to me. I'd get a little bit back. All right? So then my next stage of brilliance was, well, let's see. What if I had someone make me some of these and put them on a pedestal, kind of like a lollipop, right? Then if you hit the plate up here, it's far enough down where, you know, well, that is not as likely to happen. And it wasn't as likely. I didn't get as much back, but still it would happen. I mean, who's going to shoot perfectly? I mean, you're shooting them at whatever, 25 yards or something. You're going to hit here. You're going to hit here. So it's the same as this then. Okay? So it'll go down here and it'll splatter back. It kind of guides it back. All right? So I then evolved to swinging plates and discovered the shepherd hooks and all that. This is, of course, the plate. This is one of the extra plates for the plate array there, the swinging plates. And that's how it's designed. See, it's just, they slide over that pipe, and when you hit it, it just, you know, goes downward. It doesn't have anything down here to cause stuff to come back. Now, I guess it could up here. We never have anything come back if you hit up here, and that's kind of rounded. And then plus it's, because it gives, makes a world of difference. When you hit it, then it just splatters downward and even behind it a little bit. Okay, so swinging targets is kind of the answer. All right, that's why, as you see, almost everything that can be is swinging. That, and then plus, you don't want any edges on it. Like, I mean, I've passed up a lot of good targets, just old things lying around, some old piece from an old car or something from a construction site. You look at it, yeah, it is a big kind of a flat piece of metal, but it's got an edge over here. I saw one bad accident in a match in the 80s. As fate would have it, the guy was just watching. He wasn't even competing. He was a brother or something of somebody, a young guy. And it was early competition before IPSC in this area. And we were shooting this array, and I don't know, they had some kind of weird steel thing. It had edges on it. And a piece came back. He was standing over there minding his own business, and he caught a piece in the cheek, and they take him to the emergency room. He was bleeding like crazy. So it can happen. So you want flat steel. You want it dangling, if at all possible, so it'll give. And like the swingers and most of those plates over there. And, you know, the coffin, the cowboy, and all that. And you also want it hard steel if you possibly can, because hardened steel is even better. Because this is regular steel, mild steel. You get craters in there, then you get a little bit of the same thing, maybe. You might get some little pieces coming out away from the target, or more likely. So the harder steel you can find, the better. The harder steel you can afford, okay? AR-500, you know, is highly recommended. So that's important. Now let me show you, I wanted to show you on a swinging, the kind of the dynamics. And you can look at any target, go to a shooting range and hear, obviously in all the videos, I'm not dodging bullets all the time and dodging shrapnel. It's not hitting the camera and knocking John around. So obviously it's not too big a problem, or we wouldn't be doing it. Even though you do it at your own risk, don't try this at home, sort of disclaimer. It just goes straight down for the most part, and then that's it. It's outward and down. Let me show you here. I have set up here close enough now. I'm going to back up just a little bit, John, and we'll talk about distance too. I think the IPSC rules back when I was doing that were you weren't allowed to set steel closer than 11 yards, if I recall. I don't know if that's changed or anything. So always kind of keep that in mind, you know, 10, 11 yards, that sort of thing. And but the closer, you know, the more risk. Now I'm going to just pop those two dangling pieces of steel, and I'm going to shoot around those the 2 liter and the 12 ounces, and not hit them on the stand, but I've got some lying on the ground, and maybe this will kind of demonstrate. Let me shoot from right here, so I have to shoot around this stuff, so you'll see what I'm talking about. Look at that. There we go. I think we got about everything on the ground, and nothing came back, and you know, and hit the ones just sitting there minding their own business. So theoretically, how dumb would that be? I could have been sitting there in a chair that close, and I would not have gotten any shrapnel on me, you know, theoretically, okay? It takes nothing to penetrate one of those 12 ounces. Not much on the 2 liters, of course, but the 12 ounces, you could, you know, you breathe on those things and they break. The aluminum is, it's thinner than paper, I think. So that kind of shows you it's just going down into that stuff. I've got a couple more there by the coffin. Now the coffin is set back, I don't know, about, what, 6 or 8 inches. Got one. See, that's interesting. It almost didn't get those sitting right there because they're not directly beneath it. They're almost, but the actual, the plane, the position of that coffin is, it is about 8 inches to that side of those. So even that close, you know, it might not get it, but you see that happen in videos occasionally. Okay, so that's the dynamic, that's the physics, you know, of what bullets do. And it's really any kind of bullet, doesn't matter if it's a frangible, a jacketed, or a hard cast, a soft lead. There's not much difference. Now there is some, and we're not going to go into the differences of all that. That would be some incredibly involved scientific experiment, which we could do, but there's really not much difference. When you hit a hanging plate, hanging piece of steel, it's generally not going to come back at you, especially if it's perfectly flat and it's hard. Now, if that coffin had a bottom edge on it, you wouldn't see me shooting at it from here, you know, like those plates I mistakenly had made. All right, and as you look at the range, you can see that's why that shooting tree is made the way it is. There's nothing there, no edge that you can hit. They've got that angle right there in the middle, so it's going to divert the lead, and so there's no edges, okay? So they end up almost like a swinging plate. Over there on the far range, now the animals have pedestals. You know, they're sitting on pedestals just like this. And if you look at our range tour videos, they're old, but you can see kind of what those look like and everything. But it's far away. I wouldn't want to shoot at one of those things right here, you know, especially if I thought I might hit down low on the leg and, you know, I could end up with the same situation as that plate with the pedestal on it, all right? Plus, we just shoot at them with lower velocity. We don't shoot at them much or at all with like a 308 or 30-06 or anything like that. And just as a little aside, we used to have the targets that are on this Chapter 2 range, those thick, small, one-inch thick targets. And I had them down here about where the propane and the barrel and that stuff is. A couple of times, we actually got a 223 jacket back all the way over here. Because it would drill in and it couldn't go all the way through and it had to go somewhere and actually came back. So weird things can happen. Again, that was soft steel. Soft steel. You notice what I shoot at with rifles, with high-powered rifles, 30-06, 308, 8mm Mauser, those kinds of things. I just shoot at those red plates up there. And they're hanging and they're all hardened steel. They're AR-500. Addressing that issue, what should you shoot with a high-powered rifle? How far away and all that kind of thing? Well, you want AR-500 steel, if at all possible. And I think it's recommended by most of the manufacturers of those targets to be at 100 yards at least, is like a minimum. I think mostly that's because of target damage, okay? As far as safety, I wouldn't want to shoot at them any closer much than they are. Probably be okay at like 50 yards. You should be fine if it's AR-500 because it's not going to create a crater. It's not going into it. It's just going to, splatter just like it does here with pistol rounds. Okay. But so that's at about 75 yards, those red plates. And again, most people will tell you that's too close. The maker of those targets would. That's my problem. That's on me if they break soon. And they do. They get kind of brittle. And after about a year, I have to replace it. Depends on how much we've been shooting them and hitting them, but and what with. But they don't last forever because I have them a little bit closer than you really should. Okay, but that's okay. It's worth it to me to be safe. I don't want to put them much higher up on the hill and get. I could get them to 100 yards, but I wouldn't have the backstop that I have. So that's for a different safety reason. All right. So they're actually safer for me being a little bit closer. So hardened steel, perfectly flat, the hardest steel you can afford. Even close stuff. Now the swinging plates there, most of them are on the range right here close, are not hardened steel, all right? But they swing and they just get hit with pistol bullets. If they start developing a lot of serious craters in them, I might start getting a little bit back and I'd have to change that out, okay? Those plates, those rectangle plates down along the bottom, this bee doesn't like me talking about steel targets. Those are hardened steel, okay? And then of course the cowboy, the coffin, the big tombstone, that's all hardened stuff. And these two are hardened steel right here. They look kind of cratered because they've been painted so many times over and over, but they're hardened steel. So that's another reason I didn't feel bad about shooting at them fairly close here, for the demo. So again, just to sum it up, you don't really want to shoot at something like this. It's fun to see things get knocked over. But at close range. Now, if it was over there, way over there, and I'm shooting out with a handgun, it'd be okay. But anywhere, within whatever, 25, 35 yards or something, these pedestals, bad. Bad stuff. Don't want that. You want it swinging if at all possible. Okay? So, shoot at steel at your own risk. Wear good glasses. And I'll tell you another thing, if you've been at many shooting matches, you learn too, where there is some splatter going on or something. I learned quickly to make sure if I'm watching a match or someone shoot, not to be turned sideways, because most of the time you don't have as good a protection on the side of your glasses. You may have the best lenses in the world that would withstand a nuclear weapon or something, but if you don't have some really good protection along the sides, and they make things you can put on there, you could, as fate would have it, Murphy's always around, that little piece of lead, the one piece that's gonna come back that day, is gonna, as you know, it's gonna come back at you just when you turn your head and go right there in your eye or something. So you're better off actually looking straight on at the targets when somebody's shooting too, okay, just for a clue. All right, what else you wear is up to you. If you wanna wear a ballistic clothing, t-shirt, pants, it's up to you. So anyway, just some tips on how to be safe shooting at steel. Most of us do it, we do it a lot. And again, it flies in the face of common sense and maybe what you've been taught. So if you've never been around a shooting range, a shooting match where steel is available to shoot at, maybe this provides you some information. Because you might wander in somewhere and actually be shooting at a range. And, oh, well, they've got this stuff set up. I guess you can shoot it. And that happens at ranges. That's one reason at most ranges they won't leave steel targets out. Because someone will come and there'll be something like this set up. It's designed for a pistol round. Somebody will shoot it with a 308 or do, you know, damage it, tear it up, and all that. And then also create an unsafe situation maybe. So, flat, hard, and at the right distance. And wear good protection and just be smart about it.